either. Like a lot of people have to, by the shores of Kichigumi, and you have to memorize 124 pages. And better be off book by tomorrow, otherwise you're gonna fail. But anyway, no, I didn't have to do all that. So this summer actually was the first time I actually read it. But anyway, it's really was originally titled in 1855, Nanobush, and the publisher, Longfellow's publisher, felt if he titled it Song of Hiawatha, it would create more sales because the American public knew about Hiawatha, the Iroquois peacemaker. Well, the Iroquois peacemaker, Hiawatha, has absolutely nothing to do with Nanobush and the stories of Nanobush. And where Longfellow gathered all this research from was Henry Schoolcraft, who was a superintendent of Indian Affairs in Michigan, but he was married to an Ojibwe woman. And this Ojibwe woman, Jane Johnson is her English name, relayed numerous accounts of all these stories and the exploits and the local history and tied that all in with the present day of this figure of Nanobush. But Nanobush is simply just one magical super character. There's so many of them. And so the Song of Hiawatha is essentially all that journey. So with Garden River First Nation having sort of been affiliated with this poem for 150 years, and they've been producing it for many years up until 1967, and Ted Nolan was actually in it, and if you're any of you are hockey fans, his mother directed it. So so it had this great history. So 67 till now, 2006, it was kind of time where the community said, hey, it's 150 years, why don't we, you know, explore it again. So it meant going there and being involved with the youth, and all of them were related to some cast member over the last 100 years somehow, even the guy who dug the trench for our little canoe. So I guess just to encapsulate all that, I think when I did some training in Montreal, but even at the Native Theatre School in 86 in Montreal, was for me five things, and that was Robert Lepage, La La La, and Alanis, the real Alanis, the other Alanis. Those were all deep. These two, both Yvette and Monique's mothers, have been, you know, huge inspirational people. They're living, walking legends. You know, they really deeply, and it's so great to see that support, because my mother is a great sewer, and I think she was a designer. And my father, in residential school, he used to build all the sets for all the plays. So, you know, we had a little bit of theater in the family. But my mother's family is actually from not Wiki downtown, but Wiki in the bush. So not much to do out there. But he had a fiddle, and he had an old piano. And so I keep thinking now, yeah, I did grow up with so much music when I think about Friday and Saturday nights. And everybody just, you know, dancing and... my grandfather playing, and you know, back to work, and didn't want any handouts, so he worked hard, and all my uncles and aunts in the bush on my mother's side. So, you know, there's a big difference between South Bay and Quemakong, even though they're the same First Nation, same band, but it's where you, which part of Wiki you come from. So my father's from downtown, he moved to downtown Wiki, but he was actually raised at a place called Buzwa, or 2 O'Clock Hill, and by his grandparents. He kind of got left behind when his parents moved to Wiki, so his grandparents raised him, and he was the eldest. So all of those things, I think, you know, that whole, not having to experience residential school, but certainly knowing their stories and being raised with the parenting that you're raised with, and all of us trying to like branch out of that and come back. And the powwow came to Wiki in 1961, and my parents were on the first powwow committee. My dad was the first MC for several years. But the way they were able to convince the church to allow them to put the powwow on was if they gave all the proceeds to the church. And so therefore the priests granted them permission. So it was extra special because they were allowed to put on what had obviously not happened for a few decades. So I think that kind of all since the 60s in Wiki has really, you know, everyone thinks we've been doing this for so long, but really it's just been the 60s in my community where, you know, the culture's been expressed in an artistic form. So originally it was all song and dance.
Thank you, Alanis. Miigwech to all of you. So now we're going to make a graceful segue, and you started it, Alanis, but a nice graceful segue into what you're doing now, the kind of theater you do now, the things that drive you. Why do you do it? What are the messages? Why? For whom, perhaps? For dual audience? Oh dear. But yeah, the kinds of and maybe the kinds of things you envision, where you'd like to go. Certainly I've seen, you know, I know your work very well, Monique, and Yvette, I've seen you do, you know, create so many different forms, and now you're working, you know, the ensemble work you're doing now, and where you'd like to go with that, and you also, Alanis, sort of what you're doing and where you want to take that. Anyone jump in? Feel free.
What are we doing? What are we doing? This is the conversation we continue to have all the time. It's like, what am I doing? I run a theater company in this town that that apparently nobody has any interest in whatsoever. I don't know if it's just native theater, or if that is just symptomatic of a larger problem we have with live performance, with theater in this country. But I do, we talk about this. Monique and I spent some time in the van going to Guelph, where we were workshopping Death of a Chief, which is Native Earth's adaptation of Julius Caesar. We're back to Julius Caesar. About why, how we continue to do the work that we do if we cannot engage an audience. If there is an absolute apathy, if there's an utter lack of interest in what Aboriginal people have to say in this form, on stage, then how do we continue to do that work? I mean, we just did this tour called Honoring Theater, Crop. This is the program. And we brought in an indigenous company from Australia, Nyungyura Yarkin, Nunyar Theater. We brought in an Aboriginal, an indigenous company from New Zealand, Makarita Urali's play. It was actually a Sem Owen play. And we played with Annie Mae's Movement, which is my play. And so all three of those plays were in rep. And we played in Peterborough. We played at Peterborough, and then we played here in Toronto at this theater, and then we went to Regina at the University of Regina, and then we went to Vancouver for 2 weeks. And in every place, people were just not interested. We can't actually seem to, nobody cares. Nobody cares what we have to say. And so that's hard for theater artists because we don't just do it for ourselves. We need this part of the equation. Audience is required for theater. And if you cannot get an audience to engage with you, then you're not making theater, you're making other things. You're making, you know, therapy or text or whatever it is you're making, but it ain't theater unless it's got an audience. And I don't know what to do about that, because the work we're doing at Native Earth feels to me like important and compelling and diverse. I mean, 2 years ago we did, I'm pointing at Muriel. You keep wondering why I use people as props. We did Unnatural and Accidental Women by Marie Clements at Buddy's. I'm pointing at Muriel because she played Aunt Shady in it. And we couldn't get an audience for that. You know, like maybe 50 people, maybe this many people, but not really an audience that cares. Here we were playing, I mean, if you don't care about what I have to say, which is Annie Mae's Movement, come and see what the Australians have to say. It's a lot cheaper than traveling to Australia to see what they have to say, or to Samoa. And the plays were strong for anyone who saw them, but just not, for whatever reason, not interesting enough to a public. And not just here, but in Regina, but in Vancouver, where, so it wasn't just like our marketing, because in Vancouver, we were part of a larger season, which is the fire hall season. and in their season brochure, and still couldn't get an audience out there.